it's time to get to the Word of God, which is found in Isaiah chapter 43. As you know, we have kicked off a brand new sermon series called Skin in the Game. And let's go to that. While you're turning to Isaiah 43, verse 1 through 3, I'll start there. Let's just honor our worship team and for a wonderful job. We just celebrate AnWild Music and all that God is doing here at All Nations San Antonio. I'm telling you, the best is still yet to come. Do not cancel 2020. Isaiah 43, verse 1 says this. I want you to follow this with me. But now, says the Lord, your creator, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you, and I have called you by name. You are mine. I want you to take a moment just now and just encourage yourself with those words. I belong to him. I belong. Glory to God, to him. Let's keep moving. Verse 2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers that they will not overflow you. And when you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior, and I have given Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Saba in your place, whom I have formed, even whom I have made. Look at verse 18, and then I want you to go to verse 26. Do not call to mind the former things or ponder things of the past. Behold, I will do something new, and now it will spring forth, and will you not be aware of it? I will even make a roadway in the wilderness, rivers in the desert. I want you to go to verse 26, and this is where I'm going to hang my hat for today's discussion. Put me in remembrance, and let us argue our case together. King James says, put me in remembrance of my word, and let us argue our case together. State your cause. It's italicized in the scripture. It really means state yours, that you may be proved right. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity to share the word of God with your children yet once again. And I give you the praise and we give you the honor. Holy Spirit, do what you do, even now, that you will touch our bodies and touch our minds and prepare us for the engrafted word of God in Jesus' great name. I ask you to settle me and allow me to share this word to bless your children in Jesus' great name. Amen. I want you to put my title of this message in the chat right now, and I want you to write down the words, remind him, remind him, remind him. Type that in, remind him. If you're sitting at home, just elbow somebody and say, remind him. You got to remind him. If you're watching, wherever you're watching, air high five somebody if you're in a room with more than one person and say, remind him, remind him, remind him. Well, we started a brand new series last week on the idea of covenant. I believe that what the Spirit of God was saying to us and saying to the body of Christ in this season is we're seeing the results of covenant, or should I say, the results of people's ignorance to covenant and what covenant really means. And I'm not talking about just being connected to people. I'm talking about the covenant promises of God and God's relationship and his ability to keep his word with God's people. And when God says a thing, he means what he says. And so I want to just kind of go back a little bit for those that may have missed it last week. Let's just recap for the next 2 or 3 minutes, and then we'll jump right into what Holy Spirit is saying today, and then we're done, all right? So a covenant is an agreement enacted between two parties in which one party or both parties makes promises under an oath to perform or to refrain from certain actions stipulated in advance. It means that I'm going to make you a promise, and I'm going to commit my end of the promise by saying, this is what I'm going to do to prove to you that I'm in this thing with you, and here's some of the things that I won't do to continue to prove to you that I am with you. So God has skin in the game when he makes a promise because he backs up what he's saying. So there's four things we talked about last week that I want to rehash a little bit, rehearse and refresh you with. Number one, and you can write this down or put this in the chats, please, that God is a covenant-making God. He is a covenant-making God, that God is the only one who has the ability and the potential and the power to actually make covenant with people. God is the only one that can really institute the idea of agreement in the earth. God is the only one that can literally give you the contract by which he will hold himself accountable to make sure you understand that he is a covenant-making God. Number two, he's a covenant keeping God. Put that in the chat real quick. He's a covenant keeping God because God is the only one that can fully uphold what he just promised you. Let me tell you something. A lot of people will make you promises, but God is the only one that has the ability and the memory to stay committed to, and the power and the discipline to stay committed to what he promised you. He is a covenant keeping God. Also, he's a covenant revealing God. And this thing really marvels within my soul because we think we understand covenant, but the truth of the matter is we don't know covenant until God reveals covenant. We don't know a promise from God until God reveals that promise from God. You don't even know what to ask God or to expect or to demand from the Lord until God reveals that to you. He is a covenant revealing God. Lastly, he's a covenant enabling God, which means he has the ability to take the other party who cannot necessarily, especially us, cannot necessarily uphold our end of the bargain. But through his son, Jesus, he guaranteed, watch this, that Jesus fulfilled your end of the bargain because he knew that we couldn't. Therefore, he is a covenant enabling God. He is a covenant making God, a covenant keeping God, a covenant revealing God, and a covenant enabling God. And then on last week, we talked about what constitutes a covenant. A covenant has three parts. It has blood, it has a seal, but this is what I want to talk about today. It has words or promises. There's a covenant. Anytime God makes you a covenant, there's a promise attached to the other side of that thing. God's had words that he releases, that he gives to his children to make them feel convinced about what it is that he is bargaining in them to bring them into. That God has this way about himself that he doesn't say a thing unless he's going to back it up. So you must have the words of a covenant or the promises of a covenant, which leads me to Isaiah chapter 43. If you look at Isaiah, the book of Isaiah, the prophet of Isaiah, this man of God had great reach and great width, if you will. And he had his ministry and his prophetic responsibility was broad because he's a prophet who is what we now know as the eagle-eyed prophet, because he was able to see 800-900 years into the future to discern and ascertain the life of Christ. But also he had a governmental anointing. He was one who was able to transcend with different kings and different rulers and one to literally be able to work with different administrations that were instituted, not necessarily by God, but by mankind. He was able to operate in the rooms with this party and that party. He was able to vacillate in the structures and the halls of governmental affairs, and he was able to speak truth to power without compromising who he was. And he has the interesting assignment and task given to him by God, because he now is a prophet who has great insight and great discipline in the areas of the spirit. Can see what other prophets could not see, but he had the responsibility of judging. Judgment was in his mouth for the majority, or should I say an overwhelming majority, of the book of Isaiah. And you see between chapters 1 and chapter 42, the judgment or the laceration of God over the people of God, his people called Israel. So chapters 1 through 42, we see the power of God being demonstrated in the avenue of judgment over a people. But why? The question is, why is God judging Israel so harshly? Can I insert to you some of the reasons why? Number one, yes, of course, it was disobedience. But can I tell you, one of the main reasons that he judged Israel in the time of Isaiah is idolatry. Much of what they dealt with was idolatry. They had placed so much ahead of God, but they've allowed themselves to forget all that he had made promises for them to do for them, and they forsook that in order to become great and to become powerful, and they allowed themselves to be infatuated with governmental leaders of that day who did not necessarily believe how they believe. And God says, since you want that kind of that kind of control, that kind of leadership, then I'm going to turn you over to it and allow those people to rape you, allow them to harm you, allow them to discipline you, allow them to tear down your towns, to knock down your gates. I'm going to allow sickness and things of that nature to come upon you to teach you about who I am. This book is not necessarily about the discipline of Israel, but more so, it's the ability to bring a people to a place of repentance. Put that in the chat right now. I believe, I'm going to park here for a moment, that God allows certain things to happen to bring his people to a place of remembrance. I think sometimes that we get in trouble when we forget who God really is. And let me tell you something, whenever we start forgetting about how God can make ways in the wilderness, how God can bring us out of bondage, how God can deliver us from the snare and the handles of enemies, when we begin to forget that and think that our own strategy and how we voted and how we went to school and who we connected with and how we networked and how we've been able to preserve, we begin to lose. So God has allowed things to happen, not send them, but allow things to happen, sometimes send them, but allows things to happen to bring us to a place of repentance. This book shows us between chapter 1 and chapter 42, watch this, the judgment of God to bring his people into deliverance. And then all of a sudden, there is a hard shift. Let me tell you something. If I was in the New Testament, it would sound like this, suddenly. One of my favorite words in the New Testament is suddenly. I love "and it came to pass." I do. I love that. But suddenly's really blessed me like anything else. And let me tell you something. There is a hard suddenly between chapter 42 and chapter 43. Chapter 42 ends about the fire and the judgment, but chapter 43 is almost like God flipped the whole script overnight. It's not that he did that. It's more so Israel had learned their lesson. Ha! And in chapter 43, he opens up and he starts with this phrase. He says, "But now thus says the Lord, your creator, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel." Stop right here. Do not fear. I'm going to park there for a moment. He says, "Do not fear, for I have redeemed you, and I have called you by name. You are mine." It's almost as if as though God is reminding them of his historical past with them. Let me stop there for a moment, because somebody needs to be encouraged that you have a history with God. I want you to put that in the chat right now. I know you're saying, "Well, I'm not old, I'm at the end of my days." Let me tell you something, it's not about age, it's about experience. Has God ever brought you out of anything? Has he ever delivered you out of anything? Has he ever snatched you out of anything? Are you the same person you were 2 years ago? Probably not. Why? Because the hand of God was dealing with you in that moment, and now it is part of your history. And God tells them, he says, "Listen, I don't want you to be afraid. Do not be afraid." Now, let me help you. The reason why you can't be afraid is because, number one, I got you. Put that in chest. God's got. In this season, you need to know he's got you. It looks scary. We don't even know who the leader of the free world is, but guess what? God got us. It don't matter what they say, who's driving around with flags and no flags. Guess what? God got us. It don't matter what they're talking about. Well, we don't have to lock it down and, you know, everybody's going to get sick. It don't matter. God got it. And why does he have us? Because he's already redeemed us. He's reminding us of the historical past. And look what happens here. He says, "I've called you by name." Preach, Kevin Duhart. "I've called you by name," which is covenant language. It means that you are peculiar. There's a peculiarity about you. "I've called you by name." And I've called you by name. It speaks to covenant. Now, let me work this text for a moment, because God creates people out of covenants. Woo! You want to see a people come to pass, put a promise on it. I'll prove it to you. The Bible says that God looked at Abraham in chapter 12 of Genesis, chapter 12. He looked at Abraham and he called a people out of Abraham. He made a promise to him. He says, "Man, as you can look up in the sky, as many as I can multiply your the stars in the heaven is how I multiply your seed. Look at the sand. You see the grains of sand? I'll multiply your seed as much as the grains are in the earth. I will multiply you." He made a promise to a man and pulled a people out of a promise. Let me tell you how bad God is. There was no children of Israel until God promised them through Abraham. He pulled a people out of a promise. You and I were not a people until God made us a promise. The promise was salvation. Hey, and once we came into salvation, we became a people. We became engrafted into the Abrahamic promise. We are a part of that covenant. Put that in chat right now. I am a part of the Abrahamic covenant, which means every promise he made, Israel, is my promise because I've been engrafted in. Oh, Lord Jesus. So he called us by name. I was in Abraham. Jesus Christ. I was in Abraham. I'm a spiritual Israel, so are you. We were in Abraham when he made the covenant. Now watch this. Some of us, let me calm down. Let's keep moving. So some of us are in a covenant that God didn't make with you, but he made with somebody ahead of you. I'll give you a quick story. Years ago, I was preaching for this church, and I had a wonderful time. I came off the platform, and I mean, God moved. And this old lady walked up to me, and she said, Reverend? I said, yes, ma'am. You know, that's old school because, you know, I don't go by Reverend. But she was like, Reverend? I was like, yes, ma'am. She said, hey, I want to talk to you a little bit, baby. I said, yes, ma'am. She said, when you was preaching, you know, you sound just like your grandfather. I said, really? She said, yeah. I was looking. She said, but what you don't remember is your great-grandmother. I said, okay. Do you knew her? She said, yeah. She said, we was at a revival in the night. I think it was the 1960s, and we was at a tent outside. She said she was leaving the tent, and that old lady said these words, all of my kids and their kids' kids will be saved. What am I trying to tell you? I didn't get here because of myself. I got here because somebody else has skin in the game. God made a promise to an old lady named Mary Bell. Hey, and because of her yes to God, I'm able to do what I'm able to do right now. Because God, made a promise to another. Let me tell you something. God is so potent about his promise, and he's so serious about his promise that he don't say nothing unless he intends to bring that thing to pass. I need you to encourage yourself to let you know right now, let yourself know that God is a covenant-keeping God. Let's keep moving. So verse 2, after he tells him, after all this time of bondage and judgment and pestilence and ruin and being captured and I mean, it's bad for Israel. It's bad. The crops are dried up. Animals are dying. I mean, what do you do when the cattle are skinny? I mean, it's just a bad day. It's a hard day, man. The birds are eating stuff. I mean, it's just a bad day. It's famine in the land. Money's not worth what it used to be. Crops are dried up. I mean, it's just a bad day. All of a sudden, God says, don't fear, I got you. Things starts changing. In verse 2, he says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they will not overflow you. He's bringing them back to remember when y'all was in Egypt, and y'all was coming out of the wilderness, rather, and the rivers of the Jordan were coming, and they wouldn't overtake you. I'm with you just like I was with you then. He says, through the proverbial fire, through the fire, you will not be scorched, just like with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I'm there for that. But it's verse 3 that I want to argue real quick. He says, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior, and I have given Egypt as your ransom. Egypt for thy ransom. Which means God says, I want you to remember it was either you or Egypt. I destroyed Egypt so I could have you. Look how bad that. God did not destroy Egypt because he was mad at Pharaoh. He destroyed Egypt. First of all, God used Egypt to multiply Israel. They were already too small. He had to grow them in number for where it was going. Y'all get that later. But this is what he said. he used that, and then what happens is, I can't let my promise to them die in the wilderness or in Egypt. So I got to sacrifice Egypt to get my kids into Canaan, because that's what I promised Abraham. He's a covenant-keeping God. Are y'all here? Kevin, are you thinking this? Okay. You got to be here for this. Now, look what it says here. It's a Hebrew word in this Egypt for a ransom, which is the word kopher, which means properly, that with which anything is overlaid. When he says, I've made them as a ransom, it literally speaks to the same framework as a mercy seat. Which means I sacrificed Egypt so that you could live.
Woo!
That's what God does with his covenant. That's what God, you see, it's all tied into the blood. You got to have blood for a covenant. Oh! I allowed the enemies. He's trying to show them, I allowed your enemies to become a sacrifice so I can keep delivering you. And you're not going to trust me now? You're not going to trust me now? I'm going to end this thing right here. I'm going to land this plane here. He tells him in verse 18, now listen, do not call to mind the former things. We preach this. We like to preach this. We like to prophetically talk about, don't call to mind the former things. Behold, I would do need a new thing, and now it shall spring forth. And we prophesy, and people go crazy. But please understand, God is telling them this on the backs of them coming into a place where he's lifting the judgment off of them. That's what is coming. This behold, I would do a new thing is on the backs of a people who have felt crushed, who have felt the judgment, who have felt the lacerations behind poor decisions made against God. And so he says, now I will bring a river in the desert, or I will make ways in the wilderness. But look at verse 26, and I'll park here. He says, I want you to put me in remembrance. Put me in remembrance, and let us argue our case together. State your cause or your case that you may be proved right. That word, put me in remembrance, literally means remind me of the every plea which you has urged before me in your defense. It's the closest the Hebrew dialect gets to what we know in the Western culture as a trial. It's the closest we see to the idea of a prosecutor and a defense attorney. What he's saying is, when it comes to covenant, in this Old Testament scripture, we see in Isaiah chapter 1 through 42 that Israel is guilty. But in chapter 43, they reopened the case. And when they reopened the case, they had to submit some new evidence. The new evidence is that God still had a promise that he gave them, which did not necessarily make them innocent.
Oh, Lord.
But it expunged the record to allow them for the moment to be released from the judgment that they brought upon themselves. Please understand, because I'm talking to the nation right now. I'm trying to tell the nation that until we come to a place of repentance, we will not see the hand of God fully overflow. But the people of God, if the people of God, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face, I'm going to say this, and put him in remembrance of his word concerning us. There it is right there. So right now, let me encourage you that God wants you to put him in remembrance. So you can change his mind? No. So you can remind him of what he said about you. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 32, and I'm almost done, verse 9, that Jacob said, oh God, my father Abraham, here's the covenant. My father Abraham, God of my father Abraham, I'm sorry, and God of my father Isaac, oh Lord, who said to me, return to your country and to your relatives, and I will prosper you. He said, you're the God that told Abraham, my grand. You're the God that told Isaac, my father. And you're the God that told me that if I go back to my relatives, that you will prosper me. What is he doing? He's reminding him of his covenant. Why does that matter? Because Jacob is afraid that his brother Esau is about to kill him. And because he knows what he did to Esau in the past was foul. It was dirt. He's nervous. He's afraid. He's paranoid. He's anxious, and etc. But he reminds God of the promise of God concerning his life, and that promise is, you said you were going to bring me into a place of prosperity all I want to do is get back into, and watch this, verse 10 says, I am unworthy of all your loving kindness and all your faithfulness which you have shown to your servant, with my staff only I crossed the Jordan, and now have become two. Look at verse 11. He says, deliver me, I pray, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him that he will come and attack me and the mothers with the children. For you said, there it is, verse 12. I need you to put this in the chat right here. It's going to bless you. You said, just say that real quick. You said, matter of fact, when you start praying from this day forward, don't you pray, oh Lord, Father God, and Father God. No, you said, that's what it is. You said, Father, I love you. But you said, I adore you, I worship, I praise. But when you get ready to ask him, you said, he said, you said, I will surely prosper and make your descendants as the sand of the sea, which is too great. He said, God, I can't die. I can't die because you promised me that you were going to, listen, Jesus Christ, you promised that you was going to multiply my seeds. This don't look like multiplication yet. I need you to put that in chat right now. I can't die until everything that God has said he was going to push through me comes to pass. I need you to encourage somebody in the chat right now. Say, you can't die. You can't die. You cannot die. I don't care what the enemy's telling you when you fall asleep at night about your heart, about your body, about your brain, about your lungs, about your kidneys, about you. The devil is a liar. You are not going to die. Don't you let anxiety and fear and panic attacks and oppression and depression, and anger, that anger thing. Don't you let that stuff manipulate your mind to cause an open door to let the enemy tell you that you're going to die. You cannot die. Why can you not? Because he said some stuff about you. And right now, you got to remind him of everything he said about you. Listen, I'm glad we in a brand new facility. I'm glad that we got a brand new piece of property. I'm glad that we were on. This is something he promised me years ago, but now he's promised me more cities than this, and I can't go nowhere until I fulfill everything that my father said about. I need you to stop right now, right now. Take a minute, get up off that sofa, get up off that seat, and start telling God what he said. You said I was gonna have this business. You said that I was gonna be a lender, and you said I was gonna finish school. You said I was gonna have a family. You said you showed me, you spoke this over me, and I refused not to remind you of what you said. Who am I talking to? Because I feel strength coming into the room, and I feel some men and some women that are ready to remind God of the salvation promises, reminding God of the healing promises, reminding God of the financial promises, reminding God of the peaceful promises. I need you to open up your mouth right now. Start declaring. You too quiet. Start declaring what God said about you right now. Come on. Yeah. Now listen, he said, you said I will surely prosper you and make your descendants as the sand of the sea, which is too great to be numbered. Isaiah 62 verse 6 says this, on your walls, O Jerusalem, I have appointed watchmen. Hey, 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 I need you to put that in chat right now. I'm a watchman. I am a watchman. That's not gender specific. I am a watchman. I am a watchman. God put me on the wall to watch all day and all night that they never keep silent. Why? Because you who remind the Lord, take no rest for yourselves. God says if you're going to be up all night, you might as well be up reminding me. Don't you be up another night fussing and cussing and upset about stuff you can't change. If you're going to walk the floors, at least walk the floors reminding God. Oh, I got to stop right here. Reminding God of what he said about you. And I came to prophesy to somebody right now. If you would dare get the boldness and the girth and the attitude and the unction and the gumption to just open up your mouth and declare what God has said about you, I prophesy that before the end of this year, there's some things that God has promised you. He's been waiting on you to open up your mouth about. You got to remind him. You got to remind him. We got to remind. He wants to be reminded. It's not that he forgot. He wants you to have faith to ask him for the thing that you've been wrestling with. Open up your mouth and remind him of his word. That's the season we're in, because we are a people of covenant. And because we are a people of covenant, we have the right. Hallelujah. Hey, 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 we have the right. We have the right to remind him. God, you said some stuff. You promised me some stuff. I've read some things. Somebody may be saying right now, I can hear you saying, well, I didn't hear God say nothing to me. If you read your Bible, then you heard him say something to you. If you read a promise of healing in the Word of God, he just said that to you. If it's written in the old covenant, if it's written in the new covenant, then it's fulfilled when you remind him of his word. Remind the man of what he said. He'll never let you down. Somebody's watching this, and you've been encouraged by this word because you've been wrestling with the promises of God. I fully get it. I understand. I am sitting in, preaching in front of a promise. God promised me 10 years ago, 11 years ago, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. There's nothing that that man, listen, I got a promise one time sitting in the church. A prophet of God said to me, he said, you're a techie. You like things to be right. You fuss when stuff is not together. God's going to give you, I see the screens. I see this. I see the cameras. I see this. I see that. 9 years later, I am sitting in what that man said. Why? Because it was a promise. It was a promise from the Lord. You may not happen overnight. Some stuff can. Some stuff will. But God's going to bring that thing to pass. Every promise that you put a demand on, you can have. And you can't die until that thing's fulfilled.